everybody. Are we in a good mood tonight? Let me start off by saying right off the bat, unsolicited, you must get this book. Steal it, cause a diversion, take it. It is one of the greatest historical pieces I've read. Stephen, it is captivating. I'm not saying that just because it's true. It's history. It is absolute history.
Thank you, Lionel. I only came to get the mug. Well, maybe you blinz.
Stephen, let's start off with the question that I know you love, the most important question.
Yeah?
Why did you write this book? This is a joke. We were asking each other, Stephen, why did you write this book?
I was seduced into it by my book editor, Victoria Wilson at Alfred A. Knopf, who has a house up in the Catskills. And I said, come on, Vicky, you know, I barely go to Central Park. I'm not, trees aren't my thing. And she said, no, you know, you're gonna find a lot of colorful stories. But more importantly, it was mentioned, I wrote the biography of David Lean. David Lean made Lawrence of Arabia and The Bridge on the River Kwai and Dr. Zhivago. David said several wonderful things, but one great thing he said, it was, you know, and very British, obviously. Stephen, I've always been attracted to nuts, meaning lunatics. And what I found from the very beginning of my research, starting with Henry Hudson, he was a lunatic. Who else goes sailing in winter to find India? And in his journal, they actually saw the Catskills. He found Albany, but he didn't find India. And the lunatics just kept coming, chapter after chapter. Washington Irving, well, he was a dandy, but James Fenimore Cooper, certainly a lunatic, and especially the way he handled book critics, which I understand. But I mean, straight on through, Jay Gould and John Burroughs, who grew up together in Roxbury, Jay Gould being the robber baron, John Burroughs the great naturalist. They were lunatics in their own way, and it just continued. You know, obviously, when you say the Catskills, people think the Borscht Belt.
Right.
Well, there were lunatics there, too, and that's where these two gentlemen will come in, because when it came to the food up there, the guests were the lunatics. Anyway, so that's what got me to write the book, and the fact that Knopf was going to publish it.
What was the most important, the most fascinating parts of the research that really, because I love the organized crime references. It has such, there's fracking references.
Well,
there's
yes.
But tuberculosis.
Tuberculosis changed the Catskills. Well,
that's his next book. Tuberculosis.
No, because everything I have to say about tuberculosis was the turning point. What's not known about the Catskills, so what surprised me about the Catskills was a great bastion of anti-Semitism. Jews were not welcome. The signs flat out said, no Hebrews, no dogs. And the rich WASPs went to the hotels up there and the boarding houses and had their estates up there until it was discovered in the 1890s that the cure for tuberculosis was not going down south to a warm climate, as doctors had always recommended. That would kill the patients like that. It was discovered in Switzerland that crisp, cool mountain air would reverse the condition, in some cases cure it. So the first sanatorium opened in the Adirondacks, and it was very effective. And so the air was tested in the Catskills, and it was the same air as the Adirondacks, but the great thing about the Catskills, it's that much closer to New York City. So that became the place the consumptives would go running, and they were riding in the same train cars as the rich people who were enjoying their estates in the Catskills. And then it was discovered that, contrary to popular belief, tuberculosis was not genetic, it was contagious. So if you're on the train, the rich WASPs fled, the real estate prices plummeted, and guess who moved in? You guessed.
Great.
One of the fascinating aspects of it I mentioned was Dutch Schultz, Arthur Flegenheimer. And it is reported and reputed that his millions, his booty, his gold, his treasure, was somehow hidden. You might have heard of the story. Is there anything to that? Any
I'm here to tell you tonight that I have found the millions. And I just haven't told the IRS.
Who needs Powerball?
No, it's almost like something out of the Godfather. Dutch Schultz was gunned down in a restaurant in New Jersey. And before he expired, he died. He ran a fever, and he was rambling about money being in Sullivan County. And that got the legend going. And for all we know, it is there. There was a song in the book. Somebody supposedly had a treasure map, and he was murdered in a barber shop for that. I mean, it really does play like the last scene of The Godfather. And every spring to this day, people go up to the Catskills to dig.
Now, whenever you talk about the Catskills,
it's even in Billy Bathgate. It's part of the plot.
When people talk about the Catskills, invariably there's references made to Dirty Dancing, and because that was the first introduction that many people in this country ever had to it. How similar, how historically correct was that depiction?
It was loosely based upon. Think you probably let
Since
Arthur.
I was just saying to Stephen, I lived through Cockle Lane to the Concord. And I never experienced a place that was like, you know what a Cockle Lane is? A Cockle Lane.
Really?
Of course.
When I was born, my parents and my grandparents were still going to the Cockle Lane, which was previously a guest house, but in this case, you rented the space to live in, but you cooked alone. You had only kitchen privileges.
Kitchen, right.
So, yeah. But I don't remember that at all. I just remember them talking about it incessantly, because then we moved on to the bungalow colony. And if you read Stephen's book, brought it all back for me. There was a real progression here. So from Cockle Lane, the Jews went to bungalow colony. So we went to High Cliff Bungalow Colony when I was 5 and 6 and 7. They were already sending me to day camp, so I guess we didn't go away for the summer. But then we went to the hotels later on. So I lived that whole thing. Now, why were we starting this to begin with? Oh, Dirty Dancing had no relationship to any of my experience in the Catskills.
But that sort of stuff went on. I know from
the stuff went
on.
Yeah. Yeah, but not in that physical situation. They were, it wasn't like
it was
that.
A movie. First of all, the movie
was
shot.
There was a lot of screwing going on in the Catskills.
This is where Mort comes in.
Speaking of
in your book, you mention how there would be affairs in the hotels. But more prevalent, I think, was the men who were having affairs back in the city while their wife and family was in the mountains, like in Seven Year Itch. Yeah. Except it wasn't a timid little guy. It was, they were really screwing around.
Well, it was as a point of this development there. The other side of the fact that I had an experience working as a waiter. Now, you'd think the waiter was the person who was supposed to bring food out to the people. However, there were a lot of other insinuated jobs that, like the guy who ran the hotel, Julie Pohl. I worked at I forgot what the name of it was, whatever the hotel was.
Yeah.
And he would say, at the end of the day, at the end of the meal, I was supposed to go down, along with the other waiters, to mingle and to dance with the young daughters of the people who were there. They're supposed to have a good time.
Right.
And then also the very slight insinuation and suggestion that if there were some of the women that were there and they
So that part of Dirty Dancing was true.
Yes.
Yes.
That was probably where it was beginning, and there was this thing. Of course, at the time that I was going up there, I didn't know from top and bottom, and nobody did anything anyway. It was all seemingly a lot of talk that it was. And that's basically what that
I must say, I want to hear more about your experience, but all my reading.
I'm sure you will.
All my reading about the Catskills, not just Stephen's wonderful book, but there are many books on the Catskills. They never talk about the food, but they always talk about the waiters.
The waiters because are the best part.
Because the waiters were essential. And they also grew up to be very important people. They were all there to pay for their education.
Had I not been a waiter, I would not have done all of those other things. Yeah.
Now, Stephen, does this ring true at all? Is this at all this sordid, salacious, scabrous references to
waiters? Are you calling them? Of course.
Yes, I am calling them.
It was insinuated. That's about.
Well, it was and also
But the point, the more important part, yeah, which you do very, very well, is the fact that there was a need, almost a demand, for the waiters to become tumblers and to become a shuganist.
Do they know what a tumbler is?
Crazy. Yeah. To go and to exercise things. So,
well, for those who might not, define it.
Is the guy who kept everybody moving, you know.
Mel Brooks said, preferably before breakfast.
The entertainment director.
To do crazy.
Do crazy. Everybody in the pool, having cha-cha classes.
Right. And I was go down to the social hall with my other friend, waiter, Herbie Sturman, and we were Jerry Lewis and Dean Martin. And I would do these crazy impressions, because I was this little guy, and he was this big, tall, handsome guy. And we ripped off the Martin and Lewis routines that were just starting to get very, very popular. I would do these nutsy things in the dining room, because that's what made it most. And why were we doing this? Because we thought it'd be popular, and maybe you get bigger tips. That was the whole thing. Then we would go down to the social hall in the evening and do a show of something or other. So there was stand-up. There was all kinds of crazy stuff going on.
Now, Stephen, let me ask you, this type of activity, this was really, in many respects, the forerunner of cruise ships.
Right.
Explain how this...
Well, even more so, first, Vegas.
I was going to say the forerunner of Vegas.
Yeah, where everything would be, you never had to leave the grounds of your hotel or bungalow call or whatever.
The original all-inclusive resort.
Right, and especially with the all-you-can-eat.
As much as you can.
So if first you saw it in Vegas, you see it now in Disney World and those sorts of places. Arthur confessed to me he's never been there. Disney World. And the cruise ships today, absolutely. I mean, you're stuck in this, anything you want. You want to buy clothes, you want to buy...
Drive away and go antiquing. You can't on a cruise ship.
Well, yeah, but they didn't want you to leave the grounds.
Also, in the hotels, you could also leave your hotel and go to a better hotel where Jerry Lewis was.
That's true. Yeah, a lot of people told me about sneaking in.
Yeah.
And the guards were very cool about it, especially if you were a pretty young girl. But they were not against people sneaking in from other hotels to watch the shows.
I don't think you had to sneak in. I think they were happy to take your money.
I remember going over there, some other hotel.
One of the places had a fence that was broken purposely.
Now, Stephen, when was, if you could point in terms of history, when the Catskills, because remember, there was a historical part and historical part prior to this. When did this period that we're talking about, this epoch, when did this actually begin, where it became...
Well, the Grossingers got there in 1914, but they just owned a very run-down
boarding house. You were there, right? In 1914, right?
I was there with Lincoln. Lincoln and I were in the same hotel.
Oh, he was in the...
Who was it, Jew?
Abe Lincoln. He didn't eat kosher, though. Right.
It was the beard.
He didn't want that.
Okay, but the 14, but that started...
Yeah, but that was very small, and then it just kept growing. In 1918, they bought a formerly restricted property. And it just kept growing. Now, the heyday is after World War II. It's the first time Jews were affluent in America. And that was it. The baby boom.
And assimilation.
Right.
This was a big deal to go to these places because then you were American.
They were called country clubs because they couldn't join the Gentile country clubs. So it was actually Grossinger's Hotel and Country Club, the Concord Country Club, Kutcher's Country Club.
I think this was probably the middle 40s, though.
Yeah. Well, it started, but really after the war. It was
after the war.
And with the automobile.
Yeah.
I don't want to talk about the...
In 1939, the George Washington Bridge opened. That helped, too.
I don't want to talk about this in terms of the decline, but we must talk about it because, let's face it, today it is not what it was. What were the pivotal moments or the events that perhaps might have added to perhaps the leveling off and then finally...
Came at once. There were several elements at work all at the same time. Air conditioning came in. We're talking the mid-60s. Air conditioning, you didn't have to escape the city, really. There was the flight to the suburbs. You could have your own swimming pool. Women worked. They weren't going to, the husbands weren't going to be in the city screwing. There were cheap airfares to Europe. Now, especially the younger generation, the kids didn't.
I think.
The grandparents and the parents, the grandparents especially had not good memories of Europe, but the kids, it was, fly now, pay later. But also, Lyndon Johnson signed the Civil Rights Bill, and that meant you weren't confined to the Catskills. Jews could go stay in any hotel. You know, there's no more of that gentleman's agreement, like in that Gregory Peck movie. So, it was open.
Sort of.
Well, yeah, but legally.
Yeah, legally.
Yeah, but that's fascinating because what made it necessary was discrimination and
yes.
closed-mindedness.
Very good.
And then later on, as the country became more rational, a little bit more rational, that actually assisted in the demise, so to speak, where it wasn't as necessary.
But it was also generational. It had played out.
The world was changed. You know, can I use my family as an example?
Please.
We did go to the Catskills in the summer, not for the whole summer, but for breath of fresh air, until the mid-60s, when a club, what do they call it now? Anyway, a cabana club, for want of a better word, the Silver Gull, which is still there on Breezy Point, opened. And then my parents used to go to the ocean every, my mother would go play cards or whatever with her friends, and my father was only 15 minutes from home. He could go in the evening and have dinner, and they would be by the ocean. So there was no need to leave. We used to go then to these hotels in the winter when they were cheaper, and my father's Masonic Lodge would run weekends, long weekends to the Catskills. Mostly we went to the Concord or the Neville, rarely Grossinger's. And I was trying to remember why, and I think my father didn't like the food at Grossinger's. and
such small portions. No,
forget portions.
Yeah.
My father, who thought he was Henny Youngman. Does everybody know who Henny Youngman is? Okay.
Oh, he's great.
So you would give my father the breakfast menu in a hotel, and he would look and to the waiter and say, okay, I'll take it. So, food was very important. And actually, food was very important to everybody, even if they had no taste, because the main activity between lunch and dinner was talking about dinner and getting ready for dinner. And
well,
it was a light, it was be at the pool.
Mm-hmm. But there was food at the pool.
Well, there was food everywhere. Right?
You do that very well. You describe those scenes very, very well in the book. And I love those quotes about the food, Woody Allen, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, it was the most outstanding element that people would be speaking at. As a matter of fact, in my own case, one of the reasons I went and was getting a job at the Midwood Hotel was because it was the food. I mean, it was the food, and I knew somebody there, and I was always this very skinny little kid, and this is where the quote, I still am, right. And so somebody thought if I got all this dairy food to eat, I would get some food on. And so I had a special dispensation. I would be drinking not milk, I would be drinking sweet cream. So I had sweet cream, and that's with the sour cream, and I did the whole thing, and I ate, and I, at the end of the summer, I came home with $100, and I had lost 4 pounds.
But what I learned from Stephen's book, I sort of knew this in the back of my head, but a lot of these Catskill guest houses, eventually hotels, were run by dairy farmers. This was an extra income. They took in guests to their dairy farms. So
in fact, if you could help out, could you not? If you could help with the cows or
yeah, I don't know.
You couldn't grow crops up there. The soil was too rocky.
No, but everybody had a cow in the shtetl back in Russia, So
they had chickens and cows.
Yeah, they had cows. So I think that's why dairy was such important food on the. I'm just looking at old menus. In fact, I took some notes from some old menus, and why I wanted to talk about food is a reflection of culture and social situations, and you can tell from the menus of the Catskill hotels that Jews were aching to be assimilated, because
Please
give you a few examples here.
And the menues were that size.
It wasn't enough.
Were Wikipedia. That's what they were.
They were endless. They were encyclopedia.
Yeah.
It wasn't enough to have chicken soup. At the Concord, you had chicken broth en tasse in a cup. gefilte fish became stuffed sweetwater fish en gelée. And then, it's just so mixed up because at the Concord, every night they had a Chinese specialty. Because Jews eat Chinese food. I wrote an essay about this. It's in my book, New York
City. And not just on Christmas.
Food. Not just on Christmas. There are a lot of reasons why Jews love Chinese food.
No, they don't.
I don't want to go into them now because we're talking about the Catskills, but you had to have at least one Chinese dish on the menu. And also, we were eating Italian food. So there's, I have a menu from the Pines. It was a, I think the Pines was a very elegant hotel.
The Pines is where my grandmother went for Pesach. That okay. was a very, very terrific
It
place.
Was a I refined hotel.
A little bit
it was
more.
Sort of a step ahead.
So, what was I going to say about the Pines?
The Pines with the food.
Chinese food.
Oh, the Chinese. Well, one dish I saw was, the Italian food.
Italian.
Veal stew with ziti macaroni on casserole. I don't know where this on came from, but a lot of the hotels use the on instead of in. What else? So, this is very funny. This is a Concord menu. Under salads, there were only three items. Dill pickles, Spanish queen olives, and mixed greens with garlic dressing. See, we couldn't get away from the garlic. I grew up knowing that Gentiles didn't eat garlic, except we didn't consider Italians Gentiles. So,
Italians are always Jews.
I have a story about that. But anyway, we didn't consider them Gentile. This was also from the Concord menu, old-fashioned lentil soup with frankfurters. So, you know, you couldn't get away from
That's
certain
good.
Hamish things.
Oh, I love that.
And an item that, you like that one?
I love that
I still
stuff.
Make it.
We're actually right. cooking.
But I use chorizo now instead of frankfurters.
You make it well.
Stephen, back to the book. the illustrations alone.
Yeah.
And I can't emphasize it. Please, you'll see this book after you'll buy it. Christmas is just around the corner, or whatever holiday you care to. It's a great stocking stuffer, fine for dad or grad. And yes, Mama makes julienne fries. The illustrations. Where did you get these? How the?
It took a year. I went into private.
This is American history. This is not just about New York. That's the thing I want to, it's about.
Well, yeah, but the thing about the Catskills, it has symbiotic. New York City and the Catskills could not have existed without one another. I mean, we got our initial, the bluestone from the Catskills paved our streets. That was the first industry up there, along with the tanning industry, New York's leather industry. Everything was treated up in the Catskills. The hemlock trees were stripped. To this day, our water comes from up there. Anyway, the illustrations came from all over, they're art museums, obviously, for the Hudson River school painting. But the portraits came from museums. I went into private collections.
And postcards.
A lot of postcards because it helped popularize the postcard, the penny postcard.
We all
Private
talk about
collections.
In the news.
The publisher, you reminded me that the publisher still has all my collection. I need to claim it.
In the news, there's a lot about fracking and how this is going to affect not only the environment. What has that taught you? What?
Well, it's on hold for now. And for how long, we don't know. The governor last year, that was the last update in the book. I had to very quickly change the tenses of that chapter. There was to be fracking in the Catskills, and the argument was some of these were very depressed areas. That since the hotel's closed, there's been no industry up there, and this was going to be the way. But then there was what's this going to do to the environment? Oklahoma is having earthquakes, and it's being blamed on fracking. Mm-hmm. But then you'll have people say, no, there's been no proof.
But the governor.
The governor, yes. The Catskills right now are safe. Mm-hmm.
But in terms of the water.
It would have polluted the water.
When people
our
talk
drinking
about,
water.
And you would know this, when people talk about why are the bagels in New York better than any place on the planet.
But they're not.
What's the answer?
Oh, they are.
No, they're not.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sorry.
I'm staying out
that
of this.
That is sacrilege.
Let me say, it has nothing to do with the water.
Yes, it does.
No,
let
it
him,
doesn't.
Let him fit.
Who is this?
Have you eaten bagels in Baltimore?
No.
Okay, then go to Baltimore and tell me it's about New York water. Because you can get a better bagel in Baltimore than you can most places. I mean, I can get a great bagel
Who
in Brooklyn.
Who is... This is... I can see you tomorrow.
Hey, folks, if you want a riot at the 92nd Street. A bagel that reminds you of bagels 40 years ago.
Go to the Bronx.
Go to 7th Avenue and 12th Street in Brooklyn, the bagel hole. It's a little hole in the wall hole.
I'm not.
And the guy who owns it and makes all the bagels himself, Phil, I want to say Romero, but he's Italian, but he'll tell you his wife and children are Jewish. So he's legitimate as a bagel.
But it's not the water, it's skill.
And it's also what people want. New Yorkers don't chew anymore.
You see.
So they don't want old fashioned bagels. They want these big puffy things or sweet things.
You see, Stephen,
I mean,
the goal of that question was to try to connect the water of the Catskill.
Has nothing to do with
bagels. The necessity of water, which of course is life, fracking, how I was raised in Florida, not Florida, Florida where I'm from. I'm a native New Yorker born elsewhere, and I always heard about the water. It's the water. The water. Taste that water. Taste the tap water. This is the water. This is New York water. And I've heard this.
And it's soft water.
It's very soft water.
It's true. Finally.
Well, but finally, they have soft water in other places in the world, you know?
But if anybody were to do anything to contaminate this, this is why, because, you know, we read about environmental, I don't want to get political on you, but a lot of it's kind of theoretical. Global warming, whatever, but water, if anything affects that, because everything that we enjoy is from that particular area. That was the point.
And I filter my water these days because it tastes so bad.
Always
before you make your bagel.
I don't bake bagels, no.
Now, I must ask this about the food aspect of it. Many, many people eat, many ethnicities enjoy eating. I'm from a Sicilian background, and we ate, but this attention to food and quantities, it's much more than just having a tremendous appetite. This was life. This was years of
preparation. Well, this was after being in Europe where
this
there was no food.
Explain that. I'm sure you know that, but just in case.
But I want to say Sicilians have a similar history, too.
Always the dissenter. Always.
No, he's agreeing.
I spend a lot of time in Sicily, and you can't stop eating when you're there because people want to stoop you with a lot of
food. Okay, here's one for you. The three origins of American organized crime, all right, the three ethnicities, Sicilian, Jewish, and Irish. But what do they all have in common? They were oppressed by various forms of tyranny. And the thing that affected them most was food. If you want to really starve a culture, you literally starve the people. But go back to why it meant so much to have copious amounts.
Well, I don't think it was just so much the quantity. I think we have Jews, meaning we, and Italians, including Sicilians, have a culture of the table. It's not just about the food. It's about being together as a family. And that happens to be the activity that gets everybody together, is a meal. So
I think you're right. A family activity.
Yeah.
At one point during the day, that was attended by all the members, and it was a kind of a religion in a certain way.
Right. The kids might have gone off to play tennis or to do whatever, and the parents.
But being home
this,
but at one point, I grew up, you know, in Brooklyn, and it was, you know, my father worked, my mother worked. I would take my sister to the school, and I was working afterwards. But in the evening, we would try to be together.
Right. So there is, I spend a lot of time in Italy, and I have, you know, my sort of Italian family there. And basically, you know, it's the bonding time. And people look forward to that. And and just like in the Catskills, at lunch, they talk about what they're going to do for, well, actually, lunch the next day.
Exactly. Yeah, that's
you
the,
see, but
the conversation.
It's more just the family. There's something a little bit, it's a professional eating team. Just more than just.
Well, it became competitive.
But I must say this. I've got to say this. The aspect of the Catskills, which to me, that I wish I could have seen, because when I was growing up, my real heroes, we never had sports teams. It was comedians. And the greatest of the great. My dear friend Pat Cooper tells me that he wishes he was born Jewish or raised Jewish. He says because he says when he was a kid he wanted to be a Milton Berle. He wanted to be, that was a god to him. But in his family, his father said, "What are you, a clown? They're laughing at you?" And he couldn't understand that. What was that like to be in the midst of the greatest comedian week after week, year after year, in that one place?
Well, they expected no less. Sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, when they were beginning, they weren't yet the greatest comedians. That was what the great joy and the fertileness of it all. These great names were just trying their acts out. They were just beginning. We didn't know. I mean, Sid Caesar wanted to play the saxophone. I mean, sometimes he was a saxophone player, and he did. But this was part of the owners saying, we have to give people more. We have to give people more. So the humor part of it was the entertainment. And some of the people were kind of doing this as sort of a sideline, and they got to be really good at it. But in those early days, they weren't immediately, you know, the best and the wonderful people. But I mean, yes, Danny Kaye, but they got their names after they went, and they were discovered in these different places.
And they honed their craft.
And they honed their craft.
And because these were really tough audiences who always felt they already knew the punchline.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
They had their, you know, they could tell you.
Yeah.
And that was part of the entertainment, their own, what they brought to
it. It was a competitive thing as well. That was also the part of the eating.
Yeah.
I mean, I would be bringing out food, and it was always, I can eat more eggs than you can bring out. You know, that's kind of a thing. And at the next table, and who was going to have... It was got to be like that. How many bowls of cereal did you have today, Myron? You know,
let me say, I don't remember the quality being that good either.
Of the comedy? Of the food?
The comedy was great.
Oh, sorry, I'm a little slow.
My theory is that what...
Who is this man? He doesn't like the bagels? He doesn't like the comedy?
I love bagels.
He's a food guy.
But I like good bagels, and I'm not going to waste my calories on a puffy, you know,
Well, I agree
bagel.
With you. I mean, people went crazy for that. And I were terrible by bagels. Anyway.
I've been a food critic for 45 years.
Exactly.
I mean, I've been critical of food for 45 years.
Right, right.
And I always say the most disheartening thing in my life is watching people enjoy bad food.
Mm.
And they do every day. I go to places and I see them eating crap and they
remember,
like it.
Remember Mama Leone's.
What did that quote in your book? I've forgotten to whom it's attributed, but something talking about the food in the hotels, whatever the hotel was, and one person is saying, this food is just so terrible. She says, yes, and they serve such small portions.
It's the Woody Allen, it's the opening to Annie Hall.
Oh, okay.
Right. But it takes place in the Catskills.
I mean, that's
where else? It's a joke, I think.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah.
I'm captivated by this. But in addition to the act and the because
well, they would stand there anyway. They couldn't, you know, like us. You can't have any silences. So yes, Sid Caesar played the saxophone. But then it turned out he knew how to make sounds like an airplane, and people would come from all over to see this lunatic make sounds like an airplane. And he didn't just do it in the hotel, which it turned out was owned by his future wife's uncle. But, you know, he would do it at the Red Apple Rest, you know, when they were looking for a place to book, the next gig.
I'm so glad you mentioned the Red Apple Rest.
The Red Apple Rest.
That was the
halfway point there. You'd stop, and they supposedly had the greatest hot dogs.
Route 17.
Yeah.
But the other thing about...
Arthur, did they have the best hot dogs?
I don't remember.
Of course not. No. Horrible. Cleveland has the best
hot dogs. Let me tell you that. My father was very particular. I don't think we stopped at the Red Apple Rest. Yeah.
One other little note about the food at the hotels, which wasn't very good. It was incessant. In other words, after you had breakfast, then there was a little tea and a ganache before lunch. And then after lunch, there was something else that you had. And then
and
after
you changed
dinner, we
clothes
went,
for every
well,
meal.
Well,
oh, absolutely.
And that the
to give the illusion of time having passed.
Yeah.
Look, I'm wearing something
bringing
different.
Bringing dishes out. You know, it was a
I have a menu that has breakfast served from, 7 to 10.
Okay.
And then late breakfast served from 10 to 12.
And people stay there all day.
No.
They don't want to miss a meal. That was the worst thing that you could do.
We paid for it. The line was, we paid for it.
In every Catskills reference, there is always the obligatory picture of Will Chamberlain, who is...
He was a bellhop at Kutcher's.
But imagine you're driving up, you have no idea who Will Chamberlain is. You shove up like that, you turn, and you look, and there's a 7'2" black man who weighed about 90 pounds.
Oh, no, no,
what
no,
was
no.
that story?
Not 90, he was...
That was an expression.
I see.
Yeah, I'm exaggerating. But...
And Mrs. Kutcher made him drink his milk. And he was, and she treated him like a son. Good. Yeah, right. And he was so tall that supposedly if you had a room on the second floor, he could just take your bag and...
That's the picture that I've always seen.
Well, the picture that's in the book is very funny. It's
yeah.
Because I was trying to figure out, is this man who's coming out of the car, is he tall or short?
And that outfit of his. He looks like something out of 1984.
Yeah, he's wearing Bermuda shorts, I remember.
Yeah, and sort of a militaristic, I can't describe his cap.
And that's sure why he's
getting out of a Studebaker.
You have to buy the book in order to see.
As he's pulling up to Kutcher's and being greeted by Wilt Chamberlain.
Now, at some particular point, we have asked you to write questions down, to provide some. You hear the door opening right now? Is this amazing?
Wow.
Is this amazing? Look at this. Thank you, Arturo. Arturo.
No, Alberto. Thank you,
no, that's
call him
George
Arturo.
Okay.
George Fenneman. Alberto. And I've got some questions which came from you, and I'm going to read them in no particular order. If you don't mind, I'll let these you, the contrarian, and you two answer as well.
I'll try.
First question is, what's the square root of 11? The first one is, how much was a hotel room in the old days, and what came with it?
Yeah, I've got it. I'm very bad at numbers. I apologize.
Everything came with it.
Yeah, everything came with it. And everything was inclusive.
You must remember that. How much?
But
is,
you
no.
Still, no, except tips weren't inclusive.
No, and drinks were not.
Yeah,
alcohol,
but and alcohol wasn't a big thing up there.
You know, that the myth that Jews don't drink, it is a myth.
They drank a lot of
tea. A lot of people drank.
Really?
They drank a lot of tea, as far as I was concerned.
Yeah, okay.
In a glass.
This
a
question, glass.
It wasn't even, but like a package would be like $60 or something. For some reason, 60 is sticking in my head.
Here's a question. Rivalries between hotel owners and one-upsmanship, are there any examples that come to mind?
Well, Grossinger is in the Concord. Arthur Winarick, who made his fortune in hair tonic, he owned the Concord.
Made his fortune in hair tonic?
Yes, of course, he was bald. But anything Jenny Grossinger did, he had to do double. And actually, her pool was 1,200 square feet, his was 1,800 square feet, and Buster Crabb was the Tarzan from the movies, was the swimming instructor. You know, and they used to tint the snow, the ski slopes, so you'd have pink snow in winter. But when Milton Berle opened the Imperial Room at the Concord, the whole place had been redone, and it looked like the Fountain Blue in Miami. And Milton Berle said to the crowd opening night, "You think this is something? Next year they're going to have an indoor mountain." It was all about show. And the Concord always tried to top Grossinger's. Grossinger's was considered more orthodox. Concord was considered reform and flashier.
Now, Stephen, this is a great question. Again, what was the first thing that comes to mind, the most surprising fact, the most surprising aspect that you learned from writing this, that you did not know that is the most shocking?
What kept coming up was just the way the Catskills was always, however you describe it, the region itself, was always able to reinvent itself. And, you know, we keep going back to the Borscht Belt, but when that dried up, there was a long, dry spell. And the Catskills are hot again. You read in the Times, you know, you go up there for the weekend, Narrowsburg, Tannersville. And the property values are reasonable, and people are building multi-million-dollar homes up there. Yes, there are poverty pockets, but I mean, throughout, even you know, the Catskills would be down and out. Something then would come along.
I remember particularly on that very thing, the Catskills had died, and then I had gotten very interested in skiing, and I got an idea. I was doing cartoons and reportage for a skiing magazine. And I said, it would be funny because suddenly there was this big thing about Grossinger's and now it was the big ski resort. And Kutcher's started to be with a big ski resort. And I said, well, I'll go up for a weekend. You know, it'll be old home week and everything else. And in fact, the weekend that I went up, they had put at Grossinger's, they had made the snow pink, you know, for these reasons. And it was also a peculiar thing because the Yankees were up there. Mantle was up there, and Berra was up there, and they were all incognito. And I would go around drawing, and Berra came over and said, "We're not supposed to be here, so don't draw us." It was against their contract to be, you know, athletic, you know, because they were going to go skiing. But the point was that that was a reinvention, and it was a big thing. But who goes to the Cat? What was the name of my piece? Who goes to the Catskills to ski? And I did all the jokes and stuff about, you know, nobody worth his kosher salt would go there, and blah, 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 which they took out. Anyway, the point was that it was important to keep alive in the symphony ways. And today, they now many of those old hotels have not necessarily been destroyed. They have become other things. There's a Siddha Yoga ashram up there that's in Fallsburg. It's
that's
very
in his book too.
Yeah, well, I didn't.
Maybe he didn't get that far.
I didn't get that far. Not
don't give it away.
It's a long book.
Spoil the ending.
Okay.
Here's a question. Were the Italian Alps considered part of the Catskills? And for those who don't know, define that.
Sure. Well, yes, predominantly the Catskills were Jewish, but there, you know, there was a Greek section, there was a German section, there was an Italian section. The first African American resort in America was up there, run by Peg Leg Bates, who supposedly he was one-legged black tap dancer. He was supposedly on the Ed Sullivan Show more than any other entertainer. He had a place up there, and it went on for years. Wonderful stories in the. I talked to my friend Yvonne's mother went there. She told hysterical stories. But the you know the New York Times once asked Peg Leg, you know, when you first came, were there objections? She said, well, there was a little noise at first, but now everything's kosher.
Can you imagine today with our politically correct sensibilities, now, right here, Peg Leg Bates. You would have protests, it would not work.
No, he was profiled in the New Yorker in the 40s. He was a famous guy.
No, I know, no. Yeah. In fact, I think it was a Ted Mack. I remember one time seeing there was a fellow who had, I'm confusing him, there was another fellow who had crutches. Don't listen to me, but anyway, there was a team of mono-legged tap dancers, which is your next book, Peg Leg Bates, We Hardly Knew Ye. What are your best personal memories of the Catskills and your fondest memory? And by the way, don't hold back. If it's filthy, Mort, it doesn't matter. We're adults, we can take it.
Just because I sell cartoons to Playboy doesn't mean I'm filthy.
No.
No.
Your fondest memory.
I can't tell it.
They
talk about.
I mean, it was funny. There was the show. It was the idea of putting these shows on. I think on Saturday night when they would get these troopers that would come in up every weekend. There was a basic band there that was led by a guy by the name of Chopper Lambert, who played the trumpet. And the piano player was Dick Richardson, who was a burlesque player, a piano player in the Hudson Hotel. And Herbie and I were supposed to be doing an act that was a ripoff of a Martin and Lewis thing, and it was a big thing going on. And I was willing to go out, and at the last minute, Herbie said, "I can't go out there." He said he couldn't go on the stage to do this bit. And there was this whole room of people. I thought Julie was going to fire us on the spot because I wasn't performing then. But it was you know, serving dinner, serving tea afterwards. And somehow I managed to stand up there and do, I don't know, 10 minutes or something of.
Good for you.
And you know who resurrected that show? Peg Leg Bates. Most people don't know that.
Well, I did tap dance also at the time.
Here is a question. Was Marjorie Morningstar, was this the first Catskill film?
No. Oh, no. There was a play called Having Wonderful Time. And it was on Broadway, and it was very, what we call, ethnic, Jewish. It then, RKO made the movie, and who did they cast in it? And all they changed all the names. It was definitely a Jewish summer camp. The movie starred Ginger Rogers and Douglas Fairbanks Jr. The Tumbler was a very young red skeleton. the Ginger Rogers' best friend, who worked with her in the secretarial pool, was a young comedian named Lucille Ball. And
what's the name of the movie?
Having Wonderful Time. Turner Classic Movies runs it. It then became a Broadway musical in 1952, directed by Joshua Logan. It was Wish You Were Here. Jack Cassidy was in it. A lovely score by Harold Brown.
By the way, I just want you to see this. Did you see what he just did right now? This man is a savant. Somebody will say something, and he will go into...
Who, me?
You. It's...
Well, we didn't say in the introduction, you know, in the 80s, I was the chief entertainment writer for the New York Post.
I don't care.
So,
you know,
I learned a few things.
But seriously...
But also, it's in the book.
Yeah, but it's in the book because it's encyclopedic. Sitting in the green room, somebody said, I don't know, a name, and it was just...
Anyway, Marjorie Morningstar was shot in Lake Arrowhead, California, but also the Adirondacks, and that did the same thing with Hollywood. Although they did portray them as Jewish. Ed Wynn was really the only Jewish relative in it. It starred Natalie Wood, who was not Jewish, and Gene Kelly, who was not Jewish. Gene Kelly, get it. But it was a big deal in its time. A friend who may be here tonight loaned me the DVD. We can't see you. It's really bizarre. The Marjorie Morningstar is laughably painful, or painfully laughable. It's so bad.
If you had to think of the best Catskills trivia question, if you're out at a watering hole and somebody says, here's a question you don't know, give me one or two trivia questions that just come to mind, something that is so arcane, so...
Just open any page of the book and point. It's all trivia.
I don't think...
No.
Okay, I
can't. help. Trivia.
I make a quiz.
What about the etymology?
Well, you know, I get challenged when I've been all over the country on a book tour. And believe me, you don't want to leave New York.
you do for the bagels, but that's a different story. Tell us about that, Stephen. Tell us why.
Well,
give us your worst
experience.
Here
we have questions out there. They don't have questions because they know everything. Then they tell me if the audience is told you must ask a question, they'll say, "Did you know?" And go into. But they'll say things. Lou Goldstein, Lou Silver. Does that name mean anything to you?
No. Well, I know that name. Why do I know that name?
He led Simon Says at Grossi. Lou Goldstein.
That really is. Yeah.
See that? Dissension in the first row.
No. Are you a relative? Are you a relative of him?
No, but a close friend.
Oh, of Lou Goldstein, of Silver.
Lou Goldstein. Silver is my name. I knew it was.
No. There was also, this is a good trivia question, I don't know the answer, but there was this artist, in quotes, who worked all the hotels, and he would put like, Myron Katz? Morris Katz, right.
Wait a minute, what kind of question is that?
My
there was an artist,
an original
Morris
Katz.
What?
An original.
An original Morris Katz.
What kind of
My father thought it was a big joke, which it was.
What kind of artist? A caricature?
Didn't he paste paper on? Toilet paper, thank you. Yeah, he used to paste down paper on canvas.
That's an artist.
I'm saying, in quotes, an artist.
Okay.
He made a lot of money, and he used to go to all the hotels. And I think he was a bit of a comic at the same time.
When you mentioned the Simon Says, I saw that one time, and when you first hear that, you think, this can't be challenging. This man was a genius. I love that. Who does Simon Says anymore?
Well, this is the tumbler. This is what tumblers were doing. They go to the pool and they make up these kind of
games.
Actually, I
am friends with the last of the tumblers. I started to tell you this before, Lionel. Larry Strickler. Do you know Larry? Mm. Larry was, until it was sold, the entertainment director, that's what they called him, at Kutcher's. Mm. And Larry's wife, Shelley Strickler, was the new head of the news department at WOR for all the years I was there, and maybe once in a while. And she also, she may still be on the radio every once in a while. But anyway, Larry still sings, dances, tells jokes.
Dances with wives.
I mean, even when you go out to dinner with him, he's the tumbler. So he would have been a good guest tonight, because Larry, you know, and Kutcher's is still going on. No? It's all over?
All over.
Even the Kutcher's sports things?
Yep. Locked up.
So what's happening there?
Well, the casino is going on the Concord property.
Oh, that's the big thing now.
But that's
getting the casino.
Well, I did an event at Kutcher's, one of the last, but it was still Kutcher's. And Larry came up with this. It was a great idea. They set up tables in the hallways and put intersections in Brooklyn on each table. And they invited all kinds of and you went to the intersection that you lived in.
Coney Island Avenue.
Is that where you, Coney Island?
No, I mean, it was Church Avenue, East Third Street.
Is that where you, Church?
One of the neighborhoods.
Oh. I still live in Brooklyn, okay. Anyway, that was a lot of fun, you know, so I went to East 34th and R.
Is there anything, if we, over the weekend, decide, you know what, we're going to go, is there something there that we can do now? Is there something, anything happening?
Well, no, there's some lovely towns. Oh. There are microbreweries. There are farm-to-table restaurants. There are beautiful bread and breakfast.
Anything?
There's
nothing
skiing, here. There's sports. There's beautiful scenery.
And a lot of Hasidim.
Really?
Monroe.
They're all over now.
Well, mostly Monroe.
Well, Stephen Silverman, on behalf of a grateful nation, I cannot tell you, this is one of, and I'm not saying this just because
Thank
it's
you,
true.
Lionel.
I'm saying this because it's true. The Catskills, its history, and how it changed America. Where can people buy this? Will you be signing?
I was told in the lobby.
In the lobby?
And I'll go wherever they tell.
By the way, when I went...
I have my pens ready.
Let me tell you a quick question. I went to Kutcher's for the first time. My dear friend Milton Parker, who owned the Carnegie Deli, it was his 50th or so anniversary, and I was there, and I had never been to this place. He said, go to the lobby. And everything was happening in the lobby.
Of Kutcher's?
Yes. It was just this hub of activity. And I never forget, right before we ate, before this huge meal, we ate. And I thought this was the meal. And I thought this was fantastic. Like and I was full, and I said, this is great.
You've
well,
never been to
it's a little bar it's a little early. I'm sorry.
A bar mitzvah
I said, it's a
wedding.
Little early, but what the heck, it was a great, maybe we're turning in. They said, now we're going to eat. I thought they were kidding. We went into this dining room, and at the time, my friend said, watch this. There was the bar. The bartenders were standing there doing nothing. They had the glass with the napkin, kind of polishing it. He said, now watch this. He said, now get away from it. Get away. I said, what do you mean? He said, stand over here. He said, now watch this. Ready? He says, open bar. And the building kind of like that. And this business about people, wow, nobody's drinking my...
Yeah.
But they didn't. Peg leg Bates couldn't have kept up with these people with his wooden leg.
There was nothing like waiting for the dining room doors to open. And the waiters would be standing there, trembling, and they'd say, all right, it's lunch. It was like one of the 10 plagues of locusts coming in. And I just remembering cleaning up after all that. It was just, and it happened 5 times a day.
Stephen Silverman, again, in the lobby. The book is called The Catskills. It's history and how it changed America. Absolutely a wonderful, wonderful book. Congratulations.
Thank you. You guys.
And Arthur Schwartz, thank you. And Mort Gerberg, thank you. And thank you as well.
Thank you.